Hello everyone, my name is Shrenik Ranpura and today I'm going to talk on preparation for Certified Industrial Hygienist exam, which is being conducted by BGC, Board for Global EHS Credential. Previously, it was being known as an ABIH, American Board of Industrial Hygiene. So this course or this overview is particularly for those EHS professionals who would like to make their career in industrial hygiene field. This course will give them an insight about how to prepare for an exam, how to apply for an exam, what types of rubrics or topics covered in this exam, what are the references that you need to have for the preparation of CIH exam, and my personal experience on the preparation that may help you in preparing your study plan properly. So at the end of the course, participants will be able to understand ABIH requirement, examinations, qualification, make your own study plan, locate the resources that is required for CIH preparation, and understand each rubrics in details about what all topics are covered in each rubrics. This course module has been prepared based on BGC's CIH candidate handbook. This is my interpretation based on information from candidate handbook. I would strongly recommend you to download this handbook and go through the each requirement apart from what informations are provided here. I see many EHS professionals who would like to appear for CIH exam. They search for many books, many question data bank CDs. But my recommendation is don't buy too many books. There are certain basic preparation books and the reference CDs required. In my opinion, if you would like to buy a CD, you can buy the DataCam online CIH data bank preparation CD. It comes with questions and answers. Moreover, that there will be an explanation about an answer that why this answer is correct choice out of all four. So if you are interested, I would say for the CD, you can go with DataCam. That's my recommendations. There are other service providers available. You can explore it your own. And I would like to give confidence, or rather than give confidence, I would like to build a confidence in you that once you start preparing, I'm sure that you will pass. You need all the resources, you need proper study plan and knowledge about industrial hygiene. Once you gather those things, I am damn sure that you can pass this exam. So don't wait. If you are planning for, just first of all, go ahead and apply for your CIH application and then get it evaluated by ABIH for the examination purpose. Now, whenever you plan for a preparation, there are 16 rubrics available for the preparations. For each of the rubrics, identify which are the points that you need to read, from where you need to read. Here is an example that I used to make. For an example, if I have to prepare for non-engineering control, which is personal protective equipment, what all technical terminologies are covered in personal protective equipment? What all standards are there? Go, first of all, list down all of them. These are the technical terminologies that if you are aware about, your half of the job will be done in the preparations, like what is a penetration, what is a degradation, what different types of glove materials, natural, butyl rubber, for which type of chemical this can be used, level of protections, assigned protection factor, the grade D breathing air, the emergency shower locations, the respirator types, the noise reduction rating calculations. These are all the terminologies for the non-engineering control. So for each of the rubrics, identify the terminologies that will give you an overview that what all topics or the technical terms are covered in each of the rubrics. And moreover, it make a list of things to read from where you are going to read for non-engineering control. This was my list. I used to have a CH preparation software, that's a CD bank. Reference guide from AIHA, the OSHA's 29 CFR for respirator and personal protective equipment. I had a fundamental of industrial hygiene book, so in that chapter number 23 and 36, and then OSHA's hand protection, hearing protectors, all the guidelines that has been given. So if I had to prepare for non-engineering control, these are the 15 areas that I will read and go through it. So first of all, prepare such reference for each of the rubrics, which tells you that these are the areas I need to read for this subject. Now, many of EHS professionals might be thinking, what is in it if I become a certified industrial hygienist? First of all, it's a professional recognition. So you will be known as having a right, or I would say that good technical industrial hygiene knowledge, and you will be recognized within the EHS community as well as within your company also. It demonstrates that you have a competency in industrial hygiene. It definitely helps for financial benefits. I will take you through my journey, that how CIH and CSP has helped me, but it will help you in getting promoted, getting more incentive, getting higher pay than the other non-certified industrial hygienist or an EHS professional. So definitely this adds value on the financial benefits also. Having said that, maintaining CIH is also required. So every 5 years you will have to appear, not for an exam, but you will have to submit the points that you have gathered, the IH education during that time, and I will talk about the 40 points requirement. It is faster than the graduate school. So if you are an EHS professional, you have a degree in safety, you are planning that you want industrial hygiene degree. But if you go to the college, it will take 1 year or 2 years of the time, and you will have to leave your job and then become industrial hygiene person. But CIH, if you have a right educational background, contact ours, then you can go and appear for the CIH exam, and then you can pass without leaving your job. And of course, it helps in a personal satisfactions that you achieved one goal in your life. There may be certain goals in your life. This might be one of them. So that personal satisfactions will also be there. Now, who can be eligible for certified industrial hygienist exam? Now, you need to be in the current practice of industrial hygienist. So in your existing role, 50% of the time, you should be spending related to the industrial hygiene activity. And after your graduation, you must have more than 4 years of experience in industrial hygiene to be an eligible. So that's the first requirement on the experience. The second thing is academic, the degree that you have. You can have bachelor's degree in science or engineering or any ABET approved IH or safety course. ABET is a US based. So if any course that you have done in industrial hygiene approved by ABET, that will be acceptable. But say that you do not have approved safety or IH course with required contact hours. You will need to have 240 industrial hygiene continuing education hours, and then you can get it. If you do not have degree in industrial hygiene, you can get it by attending certain courses of industrial hygiene. But if you have ABET approved IH or safety course of that 1 hour of educations in the college, out of all the hours, at least there has to be 180 hours of academic educations in industrial hygiene. If you don't have that 180 hours educations and industrial hygiene degree, another option is attend industrial hygiene courses that is being offered outside, and then get the 240 hours of education hours for applying for CIH exam. So it is not mandatory for you to have an industrial hygiene or safety degree to become a certified industrial hygienist. But yes, you must be having degree in bachelor in science or in engineering. That is the minimum requirement. Additionally, you need IH Ethics 2 hours of course. This IH Ethics hours course, if you are in a company and your company has a business conduct policy, they conduct annual training on the ethics. Those ethics hours can be counted as ethics educations. If not, outside a training provider, they give 2 hours of IH education hours. Attending industrial hygiene conference will help you in ethics course. Recently certified industrial Central Industrial Hygiene Association, CIHA, conducted conference. And annually when CIHA conducts a conference, they give 2 hours of IH ethics education, particularly for those who would like to appear for CIHA exam. And those who has to renew their certifications, they will also need IH education. Third thing, you need to apply to the board, BGC. Once you apply and get the authorizations, it will have a 2 years of validity. Now, when you can apply? You can apply before 1st February of every year if you would like to sit in the spring exam. Spring exam happens in April and May. If you would like to appear in the fall exam, October and November, you need to submit all required documents before 1st of August of every year. So these are the requirement or the deadline to apply for CIH application. Now, there is a standard form that you need to fill up and submit it to the BGC. Additionally, there will be 2 references required. One reference from a certified industrial hygienist who can endorse that, yes, I know this person. He has required experience in industrial hygiene. And what all technical industrial hygiene skills that you have, that one reference will be given by CIH. And one reference needs to be given by your supervisor, existing or a previous supervisor who is familiar with your job of last 4 years. They can certify and give information about what all industrial hygiene work you were involved at. Once you have application applied to BGC, once they approve it, you will have authorization letter, and then you can plan to sit in the exam. In the spring, it happens in 1st April to May end. If you want to apply for fall, sit in the fall, it happens from October and November time. Now, outside Canada and US, if you have a degree, you need to get your degree evaluated to ensure that the degree outside of the US is equivalent to the US educational requirement. So there are agencies listed on BGC's candidate handbook. You can refer it and you can go through those requirements also. And you need to send your transcript to them. They will evaluate that, yes, it is equivalent to the US degree, and then they will send a report to BGC directly and one copy to you also. Okay, now say you do not have education in industrial hygiene, but you decide to have CIH certification. So how can you get the 240 hours of IH education? So there are multiple ways. You can attend BOHS online classes. There are 6 modules. Each module gives 40 hours of IH education hours. These are the topics W501, 502, 503, 505, 506, and 507. Advantage of attending BOHS is additionally you can get LFOH certifications if you pass all these topics. And additionally, there is a LFOH requirement to sit in exam. That we will cover in the later stage. But if you want 248 IH education hours, you can get it by BOHS online classes. There are various service providers who does it. You can search it online also on the BOHS website. Another way is AIHA's online courses. If you can visit AIHA.org and go to the library and the learning courses, they have 100 hours of the courses, 140 hours. So if you appear in those courses and pass, by that way also you can get 240 IH education hours. What is the fee structure? For applications of CIH, you need to spend $150. Examination fee is $350. If you go for a foreign degree evaluations, it will cost you between $90 to $100. Once you appear for the exam, you pass that exam. Congratulations in advance. So once you pass the exam, annually you need to pay $150 as a annual maintenance fee for the CIH certification. Now, only paying fees will not give you the recertification, but every 5 years you will have to go for a recertification. Now, recertification doesn't mean that every 5 years you need to go and give CIH examination. Of course, you can choose to give an exam again, but if you acquire 40 points during this 5 year cycle, then you need to submit that 40 point summary to BGC. Now it is online, and then they will approve your points and they will give you a recertification for next 5 years. Now, one question is, how can you earn this 40 points? Now, you can earn this 40 points by being in industrial hygiene practice. You can participate in industrial hygiene, EHS training, CIHA conference, AIHA conference, IOHA conference. You can teach at the college on industrial hygiene. You can present at the conference. By that way, you can get the points. You can write an article on industrial hygiene and publish it in the industrial hygiene journal. You can give a similar EHS exam, like certified safety professionals, and then you get certain points for that. And a committee service. If you are member of Central Industrial Hygiene Association, CIHA, and then you are helping CIHA in conducting annual conferences, their committee, if you are participating, or AIHA have their international affairs committee, they have their exposure assessment committee, ergonomics committee. If you are participating on those committee and giving a feedback, then you can earn points this way. Now, there are different criteria to earn the points. For every 1 hour, you get 0.17 points. So if you get 10 hours of education, you get 1.7 points. So please refer the candidate handbook. In that, you will get more detail about the way to earn the points. Now your application is approved and then you decide that yes, you want to go and give exam. So you will purchase the examinations. Once you purchase it, you can go to the Prometric Testing online website and you can decide a date. This is an online exam at Prometric Testing Centers. As we used to go for TOEFL exam, similarly, there will be an online center where you need to go log in into the computer and then give exam. total duration of exam is 5 hours, morning 2.5 hours. There is an optional break of 30 minutes, and then you have in afternoon 2.5 hours. So you can decide how you want to spend that 5 hours in one stretch continuously, that is fine. If you want a break in between, that is also acceptable. There will be total 180 questions. All will be multiple choice question. You need to choose one answer which you believe is correct. And there is no penalty for wrong questions, so do not worry and attempt all the questions that is required. Now, what is the passing score of CIH? I need to make a guess, but it would be, I'm sure, very much higher. It ranges every time differently. That is decided by BGC. So it's very difficult, but I believe anything, if you are good above 70% or in the range of 70%, probably that may be the passing score. But every year it differs. That's what I believe. So Certification process, you first need to apply online. Once you apply online, BGC will determine your eligibility and they will say that yes, you are eligible. Now you can purchase the exam. So once you purchase the exam, you can schedule this exam. After the schedule, say that 15th of November, you can go and sit on that exam. If you pass, congratulations, you get a certificate. First of all, an online information that you have passed. The detailed results will come probably within 3 to 4 weeks of the time. But say in case if you fail, you can resit again by purchasing another exam. You need to pay again $350 for scheduling this exam and then you can pass. And once you are passed, you can maintain your certification. Every 5 years, you need to apply for recertification with 40 points in place. And annually, you will need to pay $150 to maintain your certification. Now, the percentage of passing based on the candidate, this is a data from 2015 to 19. You can see in 2019 fall, total 278 participants gave an exam. Out of them, 135 passed. So around 48.6% of candidate passed this exam. So these are different rates of passing rates of year. The lowest was in 2018 spring, where 43% of the candidate passed. The highest was in 2015. This is available on BGC websites, and when I conducted CIH preparation classes at that time, I got it from the website. You will need a calculator to make a calculation in the examination. So there are approved calculators to use. There are Casio model, then HP models, Texas Instrument. In my opinion, my preference is Casio. You need to buy two calculator. Now, it is not mandatory to, but I would say you need to buy two, because in case if one malfunctions, you can switch to another one. But ensure that the two calculator is of same model. So because you have practiced that for 6 months to 1 year on the same calculator, so if you switch to another model, all the numbers formatting will be different over there. And practice properly on those calculators also. This is from the BGC's handout. You will be given the equations. So in case in ventilations, they ask you to identify the flow rate. If they will give you velocity and probably the duct diameter, you can find out the area. So equations will be there in the online examinations also. But if you would like to refer each of this equation, then there is a very, very good examples available at the end, which means equations available at the end of the manual. I don't remember, but there is one very good resource available on each of these calculation. If you on LinkedIn, Frederick or similar name, he has made an excellent explanations on doing this calculation with example. So if you would like to purchase, it is available on Amazon. That will give you the more clarity on how these calculations are being done. Now, we will understand the exam domain, that out of 180 questions, what percentage of questions comes from exposure assessment principles and practice. Then there is a control selections, implementation and validation that contains 35% of the total load. And the third is a risk management, which means 15% of the load of total examination. Now, what covers in domain one of exposure assessment principles and practice, which covers 50%. So first of all, the questions will be around the industrial hygiene, basics, assessment, and the practices like definitions, qualitative exposure assessment, industrial hygiene risk assessment, how to prioritize these hazards, sampling method and instrumentations. Once you have results in place, how do you communicate those results? What are the health effects of the chemicals that is being used? The statistical analysis, mean, median, standard deviation. What are the standards available in industrial hygiene related to asbestos, PPE, respirator selections, process knowledge in industrial hygiene to do an exposure assessment? You must be having knowledge about the process, so welding process, pharmaceutical process, steel foundry processes, mining processes, asbestos industries. Or that process knowledge that you should have, that in this process, this particular type of hazards related to industrial hygiene is present. You need to have analytical chemistry and basic science background, because when we do an industrial hygiene sampling, our samples will go for an analysis at the laboratory, and then you need to have that background of calculating that LOQ, the type of instrumentation used, like HPLC, GC, how it is being used. Those basic knowledge about the instrumentation use also needs to be there. Next is industrial hygiene control selections. Their implementation and validation, which takes 35%. So which industrial hygiene control is better based on the hierarchical control strategies, starting from elimination, substitutions, engineering control, administrative PPEs. Then the design knowledge. If you have high fumes in the area, you need to design a ventilation system. What should be the velocity inside of the duct, phase velocity, capture velocity? If noise enclosure is there, what types of materials can be used? How much of the noise reductions it may come? All those calculations also are important. Selecting personal protective equipment, measurement of ventilation parameters, that where will you measure the velocity, how will you measure the velocity. Policy development is more on industrial hygiene program, the industrial hygiene policy that you can make. Remediating hazards, once you have a hazards, how you can minimize those effects. And then validating a control. If you have a ventilation system in place, how can you validate that this ventilation system is working efficiently? So those particular aspects will be covered in the control domain. The last one is a risk management, where it talks about what are the content of industrial hygiene program, what are the regulatory requirement of OSHAs, program performance standards, how can you say that your industrial hygiene program is working efficiently, evaluating the effectiveness of the program, audit skills, knowledge of regulation standards and guidelines, mostly this OSHA knowledge. For CFR 29 CFR will help you out in getting this knowledge. Now we will go through each of the rubrics and what are the key content of each rubrics that you should be aware about. Now these are based on my knowledge. You should be preparing more than this, but in my opinion, when I started the preparing, I used to make such informations that what are the key content of each rubrics. So let us go through each rubrics, that what all topics are part of this rubrics, which has a potential to appear as a question in the examinations also. So air sampling and instrumentations, you should be aware about selection and use of air sampling equipment. How to do an calibration for sorbent tubes, vapor monitoring, how to do the calibrations for the particulates, dust samples, what air sampling strategies that you need to have in different shape, different time period, measurement of noise, radiation and heat stress, how to take those measurement. And once you have results from the laboratory, how can you convert it into the time-weighted average, or how you can interpret those results are part of the air sampling and instrumentation. In analytical chemistry, there are analysis procedures. So if you go to NIOSH and OSHA, you Google it, NIOSH analytical analysis method. For if you want to do analysis for toluene, it will give you a procedure on how, what are the media requirement, what is the flow rate requirement. In the laboratory, what instrumentation is required to conduct analysis for toluene. So those analysis procedures, a few that you should be at least aware about. What are the operating principles of gas chromatography, infrared, HPLC, UV spectro, and atomic absorption spectroscopy instruments? For which chemical, which type of instrument is used? For an example, volatile organic compound, HPLC, for metals, AAS. So different type of compounds will need different instrumentations for the analysis purpose. And in the basic science, you need to have a knowledge about basic chemistry, biology, physiology, physics, and mathematical calculations, like gas laws, preparing a concentration calculations, unit conversions from ppm to milligram per cubic meter or milligram cubic meter to ppm. All those calculations will be part of the basic science. Another rubrics for CIH preparation is biohazards. So biological agents, virus, bacteria, fungi, mold, and blood-borne pathogen program. Now, what type of diseases can come we are using by working with bacteria. You need to have knowledge that all these biological agents will pose which type of disease on human being and how you can protect a human being from preventing them from getting exposed to such biological agents. So infectious disease in industry, agriculture, home and offices, indoor air quality related issues. One of the greatest infectious, I would say, the disease in industry was Itai disease in Japan because of the cadmium poisoning into the nearby river. And that river water was being used as a agriculture for rice. And those rice were being eaten by nearby village people, and they got certain health effects. So that is also very well known Itai disease. If you can Google it, it will give you the complete detail. Biostatistics and epidemiology. There are different studies of prospective and retrospective studies, the morbidity and the mortality calculations. Now, all the health effects that has been in place, there is a study on animal that is done, and based on that, observed level, dose, and all is identified. So you need to have knowledge about how these animal experimental studies are also being done. And the references that I'm going to provide will be sufficient to get knowledge about it. Community exposure is community living nearby the industry or in the general cities, that what types of health effects they can get it, when they can get it because of the air quality, what types of monitoring is required, health effects and its calculations, the emergency response plan, the waste and water, and during the transportations, what type of hazards are there. So that will be covered in the community exposure. In engineering control, basically the ventilation system, the type of ventilation systems like local exhaust ventilation systems, the dilution ventilation systems, in the noise enclosure and absorption of the noise by providing the noise absorbing sheet, design calculations and the measurement method for the ventilation system. In ergonomics, you need to focus and learn about the anthropometry data, which means the human dimension, height, total height, shoulder height, human factors engineering, biomechanics and the work physiology, health risk analysis and hazards communications. You can refer ACGH, TLV, threshold limit value booklet, the biological exposure indices. So once chemical is absorbed inside of your body, it will get metabolite and get converted into other form of chemical. So if you want to identify exposure in the body of that chemical load, you need to have biological exposure indices. There is a IV guideline also available, standard, and there are guidelines from ANSI, ASHRAE, ASTM, and NIOSH. IV is an industrial ventilation guideline also. Industrial hygiene program management, how You can maintain the data, what data needs to be maintained, like calibration record, results, how long that you should be maintaining that record, how to conduct an industrial hygiene audit, how to develop the program for industrial hygiene, how can you communicate the results that has been received to you, and who has the accountability for industrial hygiene program management. In the noise rubrics, you should be preparing for what are the health effects of the noise. There is a calculations from dose converting into the TWA. There is an exchange rate calculations, audiometric testing. What should be the audiometric booth requirement for the noise level? How to conduct the personal noise dosimeter reading, how to provide a control for high noise area like enclosure, partition, providing them the earplugs, all those areas, knowledge that you should be having in the noise. In the non-engineering control, how can you select the personal protective equipment? If you're using a tall bin, what types of gloves be used? If you are using an acid, what types of gloves material needs to be used? What are the limitations of PPE? How to conduct the qualitative and quantitative respirator fit testing? Grade D breathing air, which is the air that is supplied in the respirator from the outer source. What should be the quality of that air? So that requirement of carbon monoxide not exceeding certain percentage, oxygen, oil-free air. So that grade D breathing air knowledge also should be, you should have. In the radiations, health effects of alpha, beta, and gamma, how to take a measurement. In the non-ionizing radiations, electromagnetic field, laser, microwaves, and infrared. Thermal stressors, health effects of thermal heat stress measurement, how to take the measurement of heat stress. There are ACGH TLBs for work and rest cycle. And what are the control measures that you can provide for the heat stress related issues? In the toxicology rubrics, you need to have a knowledge about health effects of compound, say pesticide, volatile organic compound, acids, where will they affect, which target organ is going to be at the risk, which will be the route of exposure. It is not always that inhalations will be a route of exposure. Chemical can enter through the skin, ingestion also, or injection. So you need to identify by which route the chemical is going to cause more health effects or adverse health effects on human being. There are terminologies on carcinogenic, mutagenic, and teratogenic reproductive toxins also, and you should be knowing what does the carcinogenic mean and all this terminology. You should have a knowledge about the different industrial processes and the hazards associated with those processes, like what are the hazards in confined space, in the spray painting, in the welding, hexavalent chromium, abrasive blasting, foundry, the metal related issues, and also the indoor air quality, that what should be the air changes in the room, what is the minimum CFM required, what is the carbon dioxide level, carbon monoxide level, that needs to be known for the preparations also. So that's what we talk about, the rubrics, and each rubrics, what are the potential topics that you should be aware about. Now we will talk about the references from where you can read things. I'm giving only few references which I believe will be useful, but if you want some more, you can talk to other CIH also and ask them that which one helped them. But what I'm sharing here is what helped me and how I prepared for the CIH examination. So either you can buy The Fundamental of Industrial Hygiene by Barbara, or you can buy The Occupational Environment, the Evaluation, Control and Management. We call it the right hand side one as a white book, and then the left one is a FIH Fundamental of Industrial Hygienist. And in this, there are different topics given: PPE, noise, ventilation. So figure it out which one you want to read from which book. I had both the books. Certain things I like, ventilation from Fundamental of Industrial Hygiene. For air sampling, I like the white book. So it was my choice, but you can make your choice also. Industrial Ventilation Manual by ACGIH is an excellent resource. You must have this book to know all about the ventilation terminology, the performance criteria, the design for the industrial ventilation system. This is an excellent book. You should be having, even though you are not preparing for the CIH exam, as a professional knowledge enhancement, you can have it. This OSHA guideline is available online, 29 CFR 1910. There is a standard given on how to do a calculation for the noise reduction rating, what types of respirator, what are the requirements to manage your respiratory program. The HCP is a hearing conservation program. What are the elements that is covered under OSHA for hearing conservation program? Air sampling, the LOQ, limit of quantifications, the flow rate for different chemicals, calibration methods, asbestos specific standards are also available on OSHA. So this also is available online. You can use it for your references. For toxicology, I like this toxicology principle book. If you want to know the toxic effect of volatile organic compound, you want to know about pesticides, the metals, this will give us a specific information. It's a very thick book, but very useful in the preparations also. So you in my recommendation, you should be buying it. And even today, I have this book in my hand and I love it. All of the things that we discuss, the rubrics, all the rubrics and the important content of those rubrics are in this book. So this is a must have book for you. Industrial Hygiene Reference and Study Guide. It is from AIHA web stores, you can get it. Excellent one pointer informations. For an example, toluene will affect which body part, the target organ. If you want to know, probably that information you can find out in this guidebook. So excellent, you must have this book with you. The TLB booklet by ACGIH is also useful in terms of calculations, in terms of identifying the occupational exposure limit, the biological exposure indices, heat stress, vibrations. This is a very good reference book for the examination. And then when I used to prepare for a CIH exam, we had an online class from Bowen EHS. So I used to subscribe to them. In India, there are India and Middle East, there are many good professionals who offer the CIH courses also. You should explore that option also online. So Bowen EHS flashcard is there, Bowen EHS weekly questions, and then they have a CIH games where you can download the app. And then when you're traveling in the bus, office bus, I used to play with things that let me see what types of questions are there. Am I giving the right answer? And the good part is that once you click the answer, it will give you the justifications also. And then during my time, there was an OHS hub. There were a list of questions also were there. So you can refer those references also. And if you want other CIH preparation class, I know Utpal Bausar from Sustainable EHS, he also does the examination preparation for CIH classes. So you may reach out to him also for CIH class preparation. References, also there is an AIHA university. They have a list of a bunch of books, around 40 to 50 books. You don't need to buy all the books, but you can get a subscription for 1 year membership. And during that 1 year of the time, you can access all the books online. So if you do not want to purchase all the books that I have said, you can go to this AIHA University website, get the membership, and then you can use those things. Another membership is from Bowen EHS also. You can attend monthly webinar that Russell has. He's an excellent trainer in CIH. So you can refer the Bowen EHS membership also. They have a CIH certification class. Bowen is, Russell is one of the best CIH instructor that I would say. You can prepare your own handouts. You can refer internets. If you want my handouts of CI preparations, I will give you at no cost. You can reach out to me. Discuss with your peers who are really interested in CIH. How are they preparing? And then own the books. If you're not going to get a membership, you can purchase the books for your reference. So think about what reference do you use currently for CIH preparation, and then see that are you missing anything of what my recommendation for reference is, and then you can compare yourself. Now, in next 6 to 7 slide, I'm going to take you my journey of CIH, how I prepared, how I made a calendar, how I made my preparation plan. Probably that will help you that how it benefits. So if I talk about my journey, I graduated in industrial hygiene in year 2005. In 2007, I joined 3M. After joining 3M, I started preparing for CIH. I wanted to become a CIH since long, but joining 3M, leaders like Perry Logan, Tim Johnson, all those corporate industrial hygienists, actually they motivated me in doing the CIH. And I would say that I became CIH early only because of the leaders at 3M who inspired me and continuously mentored me. So every month I had a class with Tim Johnson, who will guide me on CIH preparations, where I need to make an improvement. So such kind of mentors will really change your professional life. So I owe my certification actually to 3M, and that's the that's my I would say that success point of joining 3M. But when I passed the CIH, 3M recognized me. I was health and safety executive at the site, at the Bangalore plant. They recognized the potential and recognized the CIH certifications. They gave me responsibility of industrial hygiene for all the 3M India manufacturing sites. Now, once you have certain certifications, once one goal is achieved, you go for another goal. So I wanted to become a CSP. So I passed my CSP in year 2012. Again, from 3M, they promoted me to Ahmedabad site, complete EHS manager, and then also the subject matter expert for Asia Pacific region. I joined GE, which was another turning point of my successful career. And the person who pulled me in GE is Prashant Kumar. I thank him for giving me an opportunity to work with GE. So I was an ASEAN leader for health and safety. And in year 2018, during the restructuring time, I joined GE's renewable business for LM as a global health and safety leader. Now, I had an ambition of running my own IH consulting. So in year 2020, I left GE's role of global health and safety leader, and I am running industrial hygiene consulting since year 2020, February. So preparation strategy, study hard, establish your regular study timetable. I will show you my timetable. Follow that timetable. Do not disengage from the world. For 1 year that you are preparing for CIH exam, you will not meet your relatives, you will not talk to the friends. Don't do all those things. Those are things are also required. You may not go to certain social functions just to prepare for CIH exam. Do not do that. That is also required to release certain stress from you. Contact the mentor if you are confused. I will strongly suggest you must have one solid mentor who will guide you on CIH examination. If you want me your mentor, you are most welcome. I love to help the younger generation. I believe now I am older one, but I still love to do that job. Care for yourself, eat well, don't forget friends and family, plan the micro breaks, and try to avoid the negative folks. Stay away from those during the examination time. So this was my weekly schedule, starting from 6 a.m. till 11 p.m. What time am I going to wake up? Of course, exercise, I used to ride, but I missed most of the time. But just to motivate myself, I used to keep those things also. I used to take a printout of it and keep it at my work desk and as well as my room also personally. So travel time to the office, I used to go in a bus. It used to take, I was in Bangalore, it used to take me 45 minutes of the time. So I used to take certain printout and read it in the bus also. Once you reach the work, you can do your work. I had an excellent colleague who used to help me out certain times. If I believe I have missed certain, reading certain point, her name was Cheryl Christopher. She used to say that, Shrenik, if you want to take some half an hour break and prepare for CH exam, I will take over this permit requirement so you can go and study. So you should have such kind of colleagues at the professional level also who can support you when they can sense that you need to read more on CH, and they will come up and say that, hey, I'm there, you go ahead and do other study work. Then travel back to home on the weekdays, reading, dinner time, and the sleep time. On the weekend, used to spend most of the time in CIH reading, completing the daily job and lunch and dinner. But then again, few times we used to go for movies also. So those are acceptable, but you should have at least a solid plan to follow it, which will continuously remind you that, hey, this is what I want to do in a day. And then I also had a calendar with me. So this is my March 2009 calendar. I will mark out the topics that I want to read. So from 9th March to 12th of March, I will read analytical chemistry. From 13th to 18th, I will read radiations. From 19th, thermal stress. So it will give me a kind of push that, hey, I need to finish analytical chemistry within this 4 days of the time. So such things also you can make it for your examination preparation purpose. And then I used to do a micro planning. This is my December 2008 calendar, that in non-engineering control, if I decide that these are the 6 topics that I want to read, how much time that I'm going to spend on CH preparation software for 2 hours, what is the target date by which I want to complete it, so 28 December, and what is the actual completion date, which will give a kind of measurement that whether you are meeting your goals or not. Because in CH exam, it's not only about reading, but reading in a structured way and measuring that you are finishing all those required study that is a part of your planning purpose. So you can see I miss few goals also, but that is acceptable. At least I achieved it 3 days later rather than achieving 3 months later of the time. Make notes if you're reading ventilation, if you're reading air sampling, write notes that you feel is important. At that time in year 2009, I used to write in a book. You can still write it in a book, but if you're comfortable writing in a Word file, that is also a good way to do. Preparation strategy. On the examination day, plan to go to the examination center early, say 1 hour before the time. Ensure that you do not forget any last minute things. You should have your ID card with you, the examination letter with you, your calculator with you. All those things needs to be there. Why you need to go early over there is because you need to get comfortable with the center, because there will be certain anxiety in you when you go for the examination. So just to take out those things, you should be going early to the site. My preparation experience, start early, 1 or 2 years before the exam. I have now candidate comes and says, I want to apply in this September. Today is April, so they just have 6 months of the time, but I see them good in the preparation so they can pass it. But if you ask me, keep 1 year of the gap for the preparations, that will help you out. Apply 6 months before the submission date. So if submission date is 1st February, I would apply in August or September. So in case BGC has any query on your application, you can respond back before 1st of the February, or you can arrange the documents for them. study at least 1 hour every day and 4 hours in the weekend. By default, I made my schedule on weekend of 8 hours reading, but I was at least ensuring that 4 hours weekend reading is always there. Work in a group and share your knowledge. When I was in 3M, we had an excellent group. I used to prepare with Jesse Chen, who was a APAC IH manager. There was one more person from China, one more from Singapore, Sue, and China, Rosalie. So we four used to prepare together for the CIH exam. And we all four passed the CIH exam. So thanks to 3M and our group. Take exam with a positive attitude and confidence that you are going to pass. After having such micro planning and such detailed thing, there is no way that you cannot pass. So have confidence in yourself and go for an examination. So at the end, I would like to say, get a mentor. Use him or her as needed. At least schedule a monthly meeting with them for half an hour. Talk to them about what you are preparing, how is it going, where do you need help, where do you need more resources. The mentor is the right person to help you out. Everyone have a different style of learning. I've seen many CIH, they have not made the schedules, planning, but still they pass it. So everyone have a different learning style. You can adopt the way that you are comfortable with. Whatever I presented is not necessary that you have to make that schedule things. Figure out which works best for you. Now, use all helpful advice you agree with. Listen and talk to all the peers, the CIH is there. Now, in that certain things you may not agree, may not be helpful to you. So that's fine, but out of 10 discussion points, if there were 2 points that you agree and you feel that this can be implemented in preparation, go ahead and adopt it for the examination preparation. And study as much as possible. That's what I would say at the end. And if you want any help from me, you can reach out to me on my email ID. You can visit our website. There are certain useful resources also available. We have a YouTube channel on industrial hygiene technical terms explanation. You can subscribe to that also. So thank you very much. I hope this session was useful to you. If you would like to give any feedback, please drop an email to me. I'll be happy to help you out